But they are not the inner work that is self-care. It's not you caring about yourself so much that you don't tolerate just suffering with anxiety. You don't tolerate just suffering through depression. You don't tolerate unhealthy relationships.
Success starts with who you are, not what you do. Welcome to Garner Grove with your host, Courtney. Nurse first, entrepreneur, and your meditation and mindfulness expert. Every week, we fertilize your growth with education, inspiration, and mindful tools to help you live your fullest life and do what you came here to do. Tune in. We need you.
What's up, fam? Welcome to Garner Growth. The self-care trend is a scam. The self-care trend is a scam because it's focused more on things you need to buy in order to feel good than actually doing the things, the inner work, that it takes to feel good long-term. It fools people into thinking that they're prioritizing their self-care with things, with pampering. And there's a big difference between pampering and self-care. Self-care is two things. This is how I break it down. It's development and it's management. If you are not working on developing yourself, on your growth, on healing your trauma, on being a better person, if you're not working on managing your emotions, managing your mental health, your ability to focus, your ability to keep learning and functioning at, you know, the highest level, then you're not doing self-care. Self-care has nothing to do with how good your nails look, how good your hair looks. It's a way, it's like a dopamine band-aid, okay? And dopamine is the thing that the hormone that makes us feel a reward. It's our reward system. And when we want something or we get something and makes us feel good, then we feel satiated, we feel satisfied for a bit, right? And that's why I call it a band-aid, because you only feel satisfied as you're, you know, enjoying the look of things or laying down and getting a massage. And not that those things can't contribute to your physical health or your self-esteem, which is your mental health, right? But they are not the inner work that is self-care. It's not you caring about yourself so much that you don't tolerate just suffering with anxiety. You don't tolerate just suffering through depression. You don't tolerate unhealthy relationships. You love yourself so much that you are going to put the effort in to learn more about yourself through meditation, through journaling, through having nurturing conversations, talking to the right people, people that will be real with you and help you really see yourself. And that's why I value relationships. I have a list of my core values, and at the top of that list is relationships. Relationships are reflections of us. They allow us to see ourselves from a different perspective that we would never be able to see without that person, whether it's a friend, a spouse, children. Without their mirroring of us, without their existence, we're not going to be able to see ourselves through their eyes or experience certain parts of ourselves without those people. So relationships are number one for me. Like, if it's not relating, we not dating. That don't make any sense, but you know what I mean. You know what I mean? So self-care is two things, development and management. If you are not working on developing, man, Cora is crunching. I'm sorry if y'all can hear that. She's crunching. I gave her the knob of the bone, and she's enjoying it. It's like popcorn for dogs. But anyways... So development and management, I'm going to keep repeating that because that is self-care. But the self-care trend, what it does is it attaches self-care to consumerism. You need this in order to do self-care, in order to qualify for a person that does self-care. And self-care really speaks to people who feel like they are missing something. And that's all of us, like most people. You feel like you're missing something. You don't feel whole, feel like there's a void. You're missing emotional satisfaction. You're missing a relationship fulfillment. And so what companies do is they give you stuff to consume, or they give you things to buy or services to get that will temporarily make you feel satisfied, make you feel like, oh, I'm taking care of myself because I feel good after I did that. I feel good after I bought that. And how long do you feel good for after you do that action? And that's the really telling difference with self-care versus pampering, is with self-care, it's a constant, like, continuous process and a constant checks and balance where you're growing in your self-awareness. So you're getting to know yourself more, which is what self-awareness is. Growing in your self-awareness, and you are able to see what's happening in live action as far as emotionally. You have anxiety. Okay, I'm experiencing anxiety right now. What would self-care look like for me right now while I'm experiencing anxiety? Would it be going to get my hair done? Would it be going to go get a massage, go and get a drink with a friend? Which, I mean, those things could double as, you know, mental health, right? Talking to a friend. Drinking, not so much. It's really a Band-Aid. Y'all know that. We are way too advanced. Give ourselves credit. We know way too much to still think that drinking and any kind of, like, head change is going to change your problems from a substance. A head change that's long-term from your own self-care, from your own meditation practice, your journaling, your therapies, the things that you do to improve your mental connection, your spiritual connection, those things are long-term. But if it's a temporary thrill, just hitting that little dopamine button, you know, it goes away. And you end up back in the same exact position you're in. So you think you're taking a step forward, but then really you're just like jumping up in the air, landing back in the same place. And so you end up on this, you know, jumping up and down, and it feels like movement. It feels like a fluctuation, like something changed. But when you land from that little dopamine hit, you are back in the same place. And that can't qualify as self-care because it's not helping you. It's not helping. You're not moving, right? If we're going to qualify it, let's say, you know, it's progress. If you ain't moving nowhere, then you can't qualify that as progress. And this is not to diminish the value of pampering, of getting our nails done, getting our hair done, getting a clean shave, getting, what do they call it? A haircut. going retail therapy, which we know retail therapy is just a jump up in the air. You're landing back in the same place. It's just a dopamine hit, you know? Unless you go and buy something like a book. A book is an investment in your self-care because it's evergreen. It doesn't depreciate. If anything, like, it appreciates because you can pass a book on. Depending on what the information is, it's usually timeless. You can always apply it. Even if we're in a different period in history, books are still going to have some value, even if it's just offering a perspective of the past that we can compare to the present. So books is something that, books, courses, anything that contributes to your mental development and cognition, you're learning something. It's building upon your ideas and your beliefs of your existence. That's an investment, in my opinion. Education, any kind of education, that is an investment. If you go learn a new skill, even if you go and learn how to cook, that is evergreen. It's something that doesn't go away. And it not only has the value of whatever that skill is, but the value is the fact that you applied yourself to do something, and now you gained a new ability. You're developing. You're growing. If I were to simplify our purpose on this earth to exist, is to grow. And that's why, you know, garner growth. Like, it's really that important. Everything that exists is growing. It could be a rock. Rocks grow, right? They're growing in layers. They're condensing and getting, like, more compact. Every year, every season, the earth grows a new layer of crust. Like, it's, everything is growing. Seeds are growing. Hairs are growing. Skin cells are growing. We're growing. So the purpose, the simplest purpose of you being here is to just grow. You have the power with this mind that we have to be more engaged in your growth and not be so passive about it. When you have resistance to your growth, that's usually when we have our suffering. Resistance to growth is going through challenges and not knowing how to navigate the challenge. So instead, you end up complaining. You end up becoming a victim. You end up having all these excuses and blaming. You know, this is why it's this way. The world is going to shit. This is this. That resistance to the opportunity for you to grow in this moment, in this challenge, that resistance is what makes you feel like this sucks. Versus if you are going through the same shitty situation, right? Same situation, it's not that great. You have the opportunity to look at that challenge as an opportunity to grow, as a chance to grow. I don't want to use opportunity twice. It's kind of like excessive. And so you have this opportunity to use this challenge for growth to say, okay, what can I learn from this? What is this situation trying to teach me? Because it's definitely an opportunity for growth. So within the development and management part of self-care, there's some major subjects that I really consider. So relationships, like I talked to you about before, is one of them. Developing healthy relationships and then managing the relationships that you have, that takes inner work. It takes looking at yourself, assessing how you think, how you perceive yourself, how you perceive people, how you react emotionally to people. If you're even able to connect emotionally to people, if there's fear, anxiety when you meet people, if there's fear and anxiety when you get closer to someone, that's information that you need, that it tells you so much about yourself, so that, okay, now I know this about myself, I'm learning, so now I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna navigate this way, or I'm gonna add, you know, this skill that I learned, I'm gonna apply this knowledge that I have. And that is an engaged life, like that's being alive. That's self-care, because you care about yourself enough to not just let things happen. You care about yourself enough to, you think about self-care, think about somebody that you really love. It could be your best friend, it could be somebody, an elderly person, somebody innocent, right? A child. Because with ourselves, we don't look at ourselves as innocent. We usually are harder on ourselves than we should be. And so you give that other person so much grace, and you remind them of how much they should love themselves, the great things about them. If you see them suffering, your instinct is to help them, is to, okay, what can I do to help? What can I offer? You know, what information do I have that I can offer to help ease your pain? And the more that you love that person, the more effort you put in to try and ease their pain, or the more you want to, even if you can't. And so when we apply this to ourselves, this is self-care, right? It's not friend care, child care, elder care. This is self-care. So now apply that intensity, that care to yourself. And what would you do if you were suffering? If you had trauma, if you had mental health that was just going to shit all the time, if you were not able to manage your emotions, and you see your relationships going through the same patterns over and over, and you don't know why, you gotta find out. And the only way to find out is to dive deeper into yourself, really look at how you think, how you react. And that attention is what we need to give ourselves. Give yourself that undivided attention, which also can be called self-awareness, all right? And when you do that, you see yourself from an inner perspective. And then you also learn to use people in your life as mirrors, as reflections. So now I am seeing this multifaceted version of myself, because not only do I have my brain to work with, I got my spouse's brain, I got my kid's brain, I got my teacher's brain, I got my neighbor's brain, and I'm seeing how they react to me. I'm seeing how they talk to me, how they see me, how they interact. And it creates this bigger picture of your existence, of yourself. It takes you out of this one-mindedness where you can get tunnel vision on what's wrong, get tunnel vision on the past that the trauma that you've experienced. But when you open it up and you start to really see a broader view of who you are and what you are, it makes this space, the expansion of the perception of yourself expands the space for you to think and react. And you'll get that when you meditate. Like, it's hard for me to put into words, but when you meditate, automatically, your thoughts slow down. All right, I'm gonna take 3 breaths right now. I want you to do it with me. And after those 3 breaths, we're gonna do them slow. I want you to see the difference in how I talk, maybe how you're thinking, how you feel in your body. All right, so let's go. 1. Exhale slowly. 2. And 3. And now we're here. That was just 3 breaths. I'm talking slower. So I really did that for me. It was I tricked you into doing self-care with me. And so you can do that when you get wound up from anxiety, whether it's talking, stress at work, working with kids. I get wound up when I talk, especially when I get excited about certain things and passionate, which is good because my winding up is contagious. It's a positive energy and it draws you in, makes you want to listen more. But it also can be tiring. So by just taking those pauses and taking some deep breaths, the thoughts flow a little slower, the words come out slower, because my mind, my thoughts, my mind, in my mind, are working with my mouth, my body better. So they're working more in sync versus when you have a lot of ideas in your head, you tend to trip over them trying to come out of your mouth. They like stumble out because you have so much flowing here, you want it to all come out at one time. And your mouth is like, I can only do like this. And I have a quick tongue. I'm from a place where we talk very fast. And doing this podcast, doing singing, has really helped me to pace my speech. Oh no, doing voiceover work, that has really helped me to pace myself. Because you cannot record an audiobook talking like this and then doing the sentence all fast and everybody talking about, okay, you gotta slow down. I can't understand what you're saying, right? So I had to learn to slow down and really tell the story and give people space in between the words to react to what I was saying and also create the visuals of what I was saying. Speaking is fun. My laptop didn't die. I don't have no more outline, y'all. We're gonna do this freestyle. And I didn't want to make this a long episode because I just wanted to like have a conversational piece and not so much like something that I've researched. Like, I'm really just talking to you from the things that I've done myself over the years. The greatest gift that I've given myself is emotional management, because I wasn't raised with that. A lot of y'all wasn't raised with that, right? Our parents don't know how to manage their emotions. They're just learning now, maybe, if they got the chance. And so you find yourself not having those basic life skills of being able to manage your emotions. And by manage, I mean deal with it without taking emotional actions that cause damage and cause a mess where you have to clean up or ruin a relationship that didn't have to be ruined because you did not know how to manage your emotions and not speak from anger or speak from spite or speak from your trauma. So knowing the difference between a trauma reaction, which a lot of times we just get so used to it that you're reacting from trauma with most of your interactions. So you have to learn the difference between, is this a trauma reaction? Am I having an emotion that I need this person to know? I need to share this emotion with this person in order for us to resolve this conflict or to nurture this relationship. So it's not that you need to stop your emotions. Never do that. It's that you need to be aware of them and then have the space between your actions and your thoughts to not act compulsively. through your emotions. The way I grew up, our words are weapons, okay? No matter, there ain't no gun laws in the world that can stop the weaponization of this mouth. And I know a lot of y'all can relate. You have this mouth, these words that can be weaponized. That is the power of words. But based on how you grew up, you might be used to using words to hurt people and to get hurt. And so this is how you learn to defend yourself. And so that alone, that habit alone of using words to defend yourself in a weaponizing way and to hurt others is ruining a lot of relationships, including the one with yourself. And so if we just focus on that one thing, then we can start to build and nurture. We can start to develop these healthier relationships and then also manage the ones that we got and even heal the ones we have. There's some relationships that I've had, especially with family relationships, that were not like the best, and I just would distance, you know? And so I was like, okay, I want to have the relationship. I value it. I want it in my life. So I have to learn I have to lead the way in what I want and advocate for better communication. And that better communication includes, what are we actually talking about? What's the value in what we're talking about? Are we just sitting here gossiping? Are we talking shit? Like, are we growing in any of our conversations? Do I feel nourished and fed? Have I nourished and fed you? Have I reminded you of your greatness? Have I reminded you and made you feel loved? Have I helped you to think outside of the box that you were in that had you kind of stuck on this suffering? And if we're not contributing to each other in some way, you know, at some point in our conversations, then we really have to question like the value of them. And especially if we're walking away from those interactions, hurt, angry, you know, just feeling bad, then that is a moment of self-care that's calling out and saying, okay, how can I care for myself in a way that allows me to be engaged? When we have those conflicts, it's an opportunity for us to really look at how we're reacting in the moment. And sometimes, like, I'm like on dial-up. So I'll have a whole situation. I won't react emotionally, but like, I'll have the emotions. And so I'll just like not say a lot. And then I'll take time. Like, I might need a whole day. I might need 3 journal entries to work this out, to understand how I actually feel and what those emotions mean. So I take the time to learn what those emotions mean to me and even maybe connect them to a root cause. Now, I'll give you an example. There was a time where I really liked somebody. I would get anxious. Some of you guys know what anxious attachment is. So I would get anxious and I would find myself kind of like overthinking, thinking about this person way too much than I should, like way too much mental real estate is being taken up for what this is. It's not even that serious, right? I really thought about it. I'm like, okay, what's going on? Because we are not about to lose the days of our lives with these kind of thoughts. Like, my mental health was, my mental space was not what I knew it could be and what I wanted it to be. Anxiety is a form of suffering. Like, I don't want that. So I was like, okay, what are we gonna do about this? Through journaling, through asking myself questions, and through just meditating and feeling the emotion and knowing myself, I know my story, I know where I came from. I'm like, okay, I'm just afraid of losing it. I'm afraid of this good feeling, liking this person likes me, and what if it goes away? And that fear of losing it, another layer. Okay, abandonment. Is there any history of abandonment, any childhood experiences of abandonment, any fears that are connected to that? And you can easily see the lines being drawn and learn the patterns. And you can see also how that root of fear of abandonment also has shown up in other ways. So this is about to die, 15 seconds, has shown up in other situations. And so now you can kind of do like a autocorrect, even from the past, and be like, oh, okay, now let me jump forward and see what this really means now that I have this awareness of myself. And before we move on, I'm gonna do a shout out to our sponsor. You guys know our sponsor. It's Green Body Wellness. Can you see it? Am I doing it right? So this is the number one seller in the summertime. It is our silk body oil. It's African hibiscus, sweet orange, avocado oil. And what this does, it's a perfect blend of oils that are slick. They don't get tacky. And you put it on your inner thighs and it helps them to slide without getting sticky, right? Because you get the water and the oil the water from the sweat and then the oil mixed together. It could get really messy in there. So that oil doesn't do that. And then also the African hibiscus and the orange really help to brighten the hyperpigmentation. So when you have thick thighs, like I do, and they rub together a lot, it usually will end up getting dark. And there's nothing wrong with dark inner thighs. I think we should just like destigmatize that like we did stretch marks, right? If your thighs are touching, they're gonna make friction and they're gonna make darkness. Like that is, hyperpigmentation is caused by your cells generating more melanin, activating more melanin because they're protecting. Melanin is a protective pigment. What am I saying? So melanin is a protective pigment. So when you have friction, you have a scar, anytime your skin feels it needs to protect itself and you're a melanated person, you got it in your skin cells, it's already there, then it's going to get darker. That's just how we work. So let's destigmatize hyperpigmentation, especially when it comes to friction. But you don't have to have it be all that dark. You can use this oil and it'll brighten it up. And I only have 10 more of these left, and that'll be it for the season. It's a limited time. So greenbodywellness.com. If you have thick thighs or if you know somebody that does, get them that oil, please. It goes in your purse. I used a chubby bottle on purpose, the vape oil bottle, because I don't want it to spill. Like, you're carrying this in your purse or your bag, you don't want it to spill. Greenbodywellness.com. Thick thighs save lives, but when they're rubbed together, they make you cry. And we're back. We're gonna wrap this up with some self-care prompts. This is your call to action for this week. I want you to really evaluate your self-care practices. Write down what your self-care practices are and why you do them, what they do for you. And that's just to help you to really evaluate it. Like, am I actually doing the inner work? Am I seeing progress? Or am I just kind of like scratching an itch, you know? And then in the second part, write down your self-care goals. What do you need more of? What are the results you want to see from your self-care? And then you can write down some ideas of how you can get to those results. Or you can go research and Google or watch some more videos and find things that will really address what your goals are. So if you want to stop smoking, then you're going to want to get a book. You're going to want to watch videos. You want to consume content that is around your goal so that you fill your mind space up with those things and it becomes a lot more automatic and it becomes more of a priority in your mind. So like if we have a goal, if I want to stop smoking, and this is like smoking cigarettes, smoking weed, anything, right? If you have that goal and it's just kind of like a thought that you thought of and then you go on your day, you do all these other things and you fill your mind with all this other content, then it's easily forgotten. Like you might not even remember that you wanted to stop smoking and you just continue doing the same thing. But if you intentionally fill your mind and grow it, you grow that idea of stop smoking by consuming things around it and being even around people maybe who talk about it, who are also doing the same thing. Now you've grown this entity of your goal into a bigger thing, a bigger idea versus just a small desire, an idea, a want. You grow it, right? And now that is more prominent in your mind than other things that are not a priority. But just being intentional about filling your headspace with whatever you need to support your goal and get a bigger view of not only your goal, but why you have that goal. Why do you want to eat healthier? Okay, because you're pre-diabetic. So how does diabetes even work? And what is the cause of diabetes? What exacerbates diabetes? What makes it worse? How does stress contribute to diabetes? How does alcohol contribute to diabetes? So there's so much information out there, and we often get overwhelmed with over-consuming information that we can't apply. So my thing is consume, but like consume within your lane that you're in right now. Your lane's going to change all the time, but the lane that you're in right now, the goal that you have, consume within that lane so that even if you are over consuming, at least it's useful. At least it's intentional. You're not like over here trying to change your whole diet and lifestyle and watch 10 hours of the Anunnaki, which is really interesting, but you know, it's not going to help you with your weight loss goals. So if you are not a journaler, which see my episode on how to keep journaling. Anybody can start journaling, but to keep doing it, you're going to need some help. Okay? So there's an episode on that. This season is about being real with yourself, okay? Only you know. Only you know when you're bullshitting yourself. Be real with yourself about what you're doing, and if you're just complaining and putting labels on mental health issues. I have anxiety. I have ADHD. I have depression. But you're not actively doing anything about it. That means that you're okay with it. So if you're okay with it and you accept it, then stop complaining about it. Okay? All right, I'm gonna go change clothes and record the next episode. All right, I'll see y'all later. Peace.
Like, subscribe, share the growth.
When if you are not ready for the day, it cannot always be night.